Chapter 13, Into the 80s. In early 1980, it was clear that Radio 1 had turned the corner. It would survive, and we were in a pretty commanding position. More hours had resulted in a 6% increase in audience share. We had shown that we could more than hold our own against the commercial competition. We introduced our own style of talk-based shows in the early evening schedule, Staying Alive, Wheels, Personal Call, etc., and by doing this we were taken a little more seriously by the BBC establishment. It shouldn't have needed these things to achieve that result, but I was realistic enough to accept that this was the way things were within the BBC. Apart from these worthy speech-based mid-evening programmes in 1980, we started what was to be a very important innovation, social action broadcasting. This was not a new concept, having been introduced in a much earlier period between the two world wars under John Reith. In those days, the BBC had broadcast interviews with unemployed people, much to the displeasure of the government of the time. It wanted the BBC to stop doing this because it found them embarrassing, to which Lord Reith said, "If I do so, I will have to say it's at the government's request." Naturally, they continued. What's even more interesting, though, is that the producer of that first-ever social action programme was a certain Guy Burgess. Not many people know that he was the originator of social action broadcasting. Our campaigns were more of an up-to-date nature and were concentrated efforts, usually lasting for a week, offering help to a section of our audience which was at a social disadvantage. This was to become an important plank in the case for Radio 1's continued existence. The first one we did was about helping unemployed youngsters to find jobs. Action Special was the generic name for this campaign, and each one was aimed at a different age group. Funding for the backup support services, print material and so on came from the Department of Employment. It was made very clear that in order to preserve the BBC's independence, there was to be no kind of editorial interference with the on-air programme content. In fact, it went the other way, because we had editorial control over the printed content in their associated leaflets too. We were also separate now from Radio 2 during the daytimes, though during the night from midnight to 6 a.m. we still rebroadcast Radio 2. The Radio 1 Weeks Out continued. In the spring we found ourselves based in Nottingham. I remember Dave Lee Travis bravely doing his breakfast show from the roadshow stage to a crowd that were being gently powdered with snowflakes. The hairy cornflake was more of a hairy snowflake that day. Behind the scenes there was a degree of conflict when tempers became frayed under the strain of the late nights, the charity discos and the alcoholic excess. One incident came to a head early one morning over breakfast in the Victoria Hotel. Simon Bates had been to London and back the night before to record one of our talk shows, Personal Call. He came down for breakfast feeling pretty shattered. Also in the dining room was Kid Jensen. He and Simon were waiting for their producer, Paul Williams. Simon was anxious to get away with Paul on a trip they were to make in the radio car, touring a nearby colliery. Although it was to be a touring outside broadcast, Simon always presented his Golden Hour feature in the first hour, and to do this he needed his valuable research notes, which gave him the relevant headlines and data for the chosen year.
"Come along, Paul, it's time we were gone."
Willie shuffled in with a ubiquitous cigarette in his mouth, stopwatch in one hand, papers all over the place. He was a good producer, but somewhat disorganised.
"Have you got my Golden Hour notes?"
Willie scrabbled through a wadge of background paperwork about the colliery visit. "Oh, hang on, Simon, I can't seem to find the Golden Hour stuff." That was it. Simon Bates totally lost it, and for a moment went mad, grabbing poor Willie by the throat and screaming at him in front of a bemused group of other hotel guests at the top of his powerful voice. Bates used language which he would never have got away with on the air, the gist of which was that Paul's parents had never been married, he was the most fucking incompetent producer he, Simon, had ever worked with, and if he never saw him again it would be too soon, and if he had the means he would kill Paul. It went on in this vein for a couple of minutes, after which Bates stormed off to the radio car to wait for Kid Jensen, Paul Williams and the luckless secretary to join him with the missing notes. For a day or so the remainder of the team sent Simon to Coventry for being so abusive. But later that evening Paul Burnett, who was a kindly soul, saw Simon on his own in the bar and went over for a chat. Simon was smoking a large cigar. Paul asked him about his day, and as Simon replied, he waved his hands about expressively, and in doing so, stubbed the cigar on Paul's nose. Howls of pain from Paul, and a large blister which decorated his face for the remainder of the week. The remainder of that week was quite calm by comparison, and the row was forgotten by the next evening. There had to be repercussions, and a couple of weeks later, Paul Williams was replaced as producer by Dave Atke. Tony Blackburn moved on to take over as Uncle Tony on Junior Choice on Saturday and Sunday morning, so Ed Stewart was moved sideways. He'd presented the Children's Request show for 12 years and shuffled off to Radio 2. And as we said farewell to Ed, we welcomed another new arrival, who initially was very full of himself, Steve Wright. Steve, who'd been at Radio Thames Valley and then Radio Luxembourg prior to his arrival at Radio 1, drew attention to himself at a Radio 1 roadshow. This was where we were covering a 24-hour lawnmower race. A 24-hour what? A lawnmower race. Yes, I know it sounds daft now, but these events were going on, large number of people were in attendance, and many of them were Radio 1 listeners. The producer of the roadshow was the much-loved and respected Brian Patton, and Steve, knowing no better, was very dismissive of this person who he regarded, frankly, as an old fart. What does he know about pop radio? Was the gist of his criticism on being directed by Brian during the show. I had to put him right fairly forcibly, and thankfully Steve didn't take too long to find out how the BBC worked and developed into a very good broadcaster. Paul Gambaccini recognised Steve's talent very early on, writing, "With his wit and style, he will appeal to both the general and the slightly hip audience. Steve Wright is likely to be one of the network's big names in the 80s, so you should get to know him before 7 million others do." Once again proving Paul has an uncanny gift for accurate prophecy. In May, there was another hiccup in our development when there were more financial cutbacks, disputes involving PPL, Phonographic Performance Limited, and the knotty subject of needle time. This led to yet another cutback in hours, and some of the BBC recording sessions had to be abandoned due to a very bitter dispute with the Musicians' Union. This resulted in an effigy of Aubrey Singer, the managing director of radio, being hung from a balcony on the roof of Broadcasting House. Luckily for Aubrey, they couldn't get him in person, though if they had, they would have needed a pretty thick rope. I woke early on December the 8th and turned to Radio 1 for the 6:30 news. What a horrible, rude and shocking awakening that was. John Lennon was shot dead outside his home yesterday evening. He was shot 4 times as he got out of a limousine with his wife Yoko Ono outside their New York apartment. I rushed straight off to work in a state of shock. I knew John, of course, from the earlier work I had done on the Beatles story and the story of Pop, and I also knew that we had sent Doreen Davis, Paul Williams and Andy Peebles to New York a few days earlier. These three had originally gone to set up 2 projects, an interview with David Bowie, who was appearing on Broadway in The Elephant Man, and also to meet John Lennon and Yoko Ono, who had agreed to cooperate on a feature about their new album, Double Fantasy. Doreen told me what went on.
"We met up in the apartment where John lived with Yoko, the Dakota, and after talking through what we wanted, we went to a commercial record studio and had wide-ranging discussions for 2.5 hours, which filled 5 large reels of tape. As we came to the end, I said to John, 'May we buy you dinner?' John said, 'Bloody hell, it's the first time the BBC has ever given me a meal. Of course we'd love that.' 'Mother,'" he always called Yoko Mother, "'please book us a table at Mr. Chow's.' The double-stretched limo came to pick up Andy, Paul and me. John and Yoko were already in the car, dressed all in black, and as we walked into the restaurant, there was quite a hush. At the end of the meal, I went to pick up the tab, and I was so embarrassed because I had left all my credit cards behind in my hotel. John laughed, and in the end, he paid. The oddest thing was that in the course of the interview, John had told Andy, 'At least people here in New York don't bug you.' That was the last time we saw him. Unknown to us, while we were flying home, Derek Chinnery had phoned my husband Derek and suggested that he should go to Heathrow to help us deal with the inevitable crowd. When we landed, of course, there were masses of press people there, and we had to cope with that, which was tricky, as Derek Chinnery had ordered us not to talk to them, and we needed to get the tapes back to the BBC. When we arrived at Radio 1's Egton House, there were more chaotic scenes, with all the press looking for an interview with Andy Peebles. On top of that, there was trouble, because the record company where we had recorded the interview tried to claim ownership of the tapes. Derek fought them off, and I sought help from another producer, Dave Tate, to select suitable music while I edited. Between us, we produced a special programme, which was broadcast at 10 a.m. that same morning.
Two more of my promotional gimmicks were going well at the end of 1980. We had a new line with Collins, the diary people who produced the Radio 1 diary, devised and edited by John Pidgeon. He was then a freelance writer, but later he became head of Radio Light Entertainment. The other was the Radio 1 calendar. This had been produced and sold by mail order by Radio 1 Offers, the Miles Brothers. It was very popular with our listeners, though inevitably there were some insecurity squabbles between DJs and me over who was going to be placed in the earlier months of the year. Oh, if I'm in January, people will think I might not be here by the end of the following year. Why can't I be in December? We ran into trouble the first year over the delivery method. Noel had obtained his helicopter license and was happy to cooperate in a picture stunt by delivering the first editions personally with his helicopter. The Daily Express took great exception and their critic went into print, attacking us for a waste of license payers' money. Luckily, Derek Chinnery was able to see the critic, James Murray, off with a flea up his kilt when he told him, Noel owns the helicopter and he paid for the fuel himself. It probably sold even more calendars to people who wanted to see what all the fuss was about. Pity I'd not arranged for them to pose in the nude, then we could have preempted the success of the calendar girls. The naked truth about Radio 1 DJs, or look how big my ego is. As we moved into the new year, 1981, we decided it was time for the hairy cornflake to come off the breakfast show, and on January the 5th, Dave made way for Mike Reed, who was, I assume, thrilled to be given the prestigious job of waking the country. He was produced by John Sparrow, a somewhat humourless man, who looked a little like Noel Edmonds' gnome as he sported a red beard, the hairs of which he twirled between his fingers in time of stress, and the stress wasn't long in coming. In their show, John and Mike had instigated a not-very-good club, which was a bit of fun whereby listeners could write in nominating someone who was not very good at their job. Unfortunately, John and Mike were silly enough to take everything at face value and read letters out without checking their authenticity. In one case, a pupil had written from a school in Scotland, north of the border, alleging that the particular teacher they were writing about was not very good because he had a nickname, and he belts you if he hears you using it. One day he was driving his car on a snowy road and someone called his nickname out to him. He was so cross he lost control and crashed the car. The letter went on and on, talking about misfire alarms, experiments which had gone wrong to the harm of pupils, and so on. The problem was it was a malicious hoax, written as it turned out by a pupil who'd been expelled for his antisocial behaviour. The Scottish press got hold of that fact and ran an unfavourable story about it. Other pupils from the school wrote defending the teacher, and before we knew it, lawyers' letters were being exchanged between the company representing the teacher and the BBC. As controller, poor old Derek Chinnery was held responsible. He was caught in the middle. Publicly, he had to defend his team, but behind the scenes, he had to find out the facts and try to reach a settlement. In the end, we had to send a letter of apology, and the BBC had to pay out compensation to the much maligned teacher. Mike Reed and John Sparrow learned an expensive lesson. Trouble didn't stop there. We were always trying to encourage DJs to think before they opened their microphone. There was never much love lost between Mike Reed and Simon Bates, and at 9 a.m. every morning, Mike would have to do a handover to Simon. This was an opportunity to score off each other with inane chatter, which often went on too long and was frankly embarrassing to listen to. After a number of these rather silly handovers, there was one that went far too far. Derek wrote a formal warning to both of them. This morning's effort was banal and embarrassing. Why two intelligent and supposedly inventive broadcasters on a national network should have to resort to unpleasant trivia, I don't know. If you can't achieve a normal, civilized, and occasionally amusing exchange, then I will arrange matters so that you don't talk at all. For goodness sake, please think before you speak in future. Well, that served to shut them up for a while, but handovers were frequently a source of irritation and friction. I don't know why, but I suppose there's a competitive streak in the mind of every performer, and they've always got to prove they're smarter than the man or woman who follows them. Now, don't run away with the idea that Mike Reed was some sort of bête noire of mine. He would never have been given the breakfast show if we didn't think he could do it. He just had a very casual attitude. He introduced regular features like First Love, gave away special teehee mugs for original listeners' letters, and of course was always ready to entertain with his ever-present guitar. In 1982, 83 and 84, he won the Smash Hits Best DJ Award as a result of the Reader's Survey. The younger end of the audience who read that magazine loved him, and so did his fellow radio practitioners. In 1984, he won a well-deserved Sony Award for Best Breakfast Show Presenter. Mike was a hugely popular DJ, and we almost had a repeat of the Bay City Rollers affair when we did our first Teddy Bears Picnic Roadshow with him and Peter Powell at Castle Howard in Yorkshire. Castle Howard was the home of George Howard, who'd been the flamboyant chairman of the BBC Governors from 1980 to 1983. He had a penchant for rolling up at popular functions in copious caftans, usually with a beautiful girl on his arm. Castle Howard had also become famous to a television audience as the location where many of the exteriors for Brideshead Revisited had been filmed. Like many of these stately homes, there was a continual problem over funding the upkeep, so George and his sons had opened it to the public. It was made known to me that he wouldn't be averse to having the roadshow there. I drove up one day to do a recce and was made very welcome by his son, Simon Howard. After coffee and a discussion of what we might do, we had a look round, and I decided it would be the perfect location for a bank holiday special with Mike Reed. Mike had long been a fan of Rupert Bear, so Doreen Davis devised the notion of a Teddy Bears picnic, where the fans could be entertained by Mike Reed, and they could bring their teddies for a day out in the sun at the roadshow. George Howard would bring his teddy bear along, and the gate money would be split between a charity of our choice and Castle Howard. For a change on that bank holiday, the weather was perfect, but again we had underestimated the power and attraction of Radio 1. I wasn't involved in the production, but I wanted to see how it turned out, so I arranged to spend the bank holiday weekend with some friends who lived in nearby Drax. We planned to drive up on the Monday morning, taking our picnic with us to enjoy the show as if we were normal Radio 1 listeners. From Drax to Castle Howard is no great distance, an hour in the car at most, and we set off mid-morning, but by 1 o'clock we were stuck in the most enormous traffic jam. The show started at 2, but by that time we were still 5 miles from the castle, and there was no chance of getting in to see the show. I remember Derek Chinnery being in the reverse situation when we staged Mallory Park, and now here was I missing one of my own programmes. I phoned the roadshow to find out what had happened, and it appeared that local police had totally underestimated the size of the crowds and didn't have enough police on duty. George Howard's staff, too, didn't have nearly enough parking supervisors or space for all the cars which had arrived. There wasn't enough staff to cover the many entrances either, so at least half the crowd managed to get in without paying. All in all, it was badly managed. Doreen Davis told me next day that the thing that tickled her most was seeing so many bikers in their heavy metal gear turning up with their teddy bears sticking out of pannier pockets or stuffed down the front of their leather jackets. All we could do was arrange to put out traffic news advising people to avoid the area, and my personal little party finished up having a picnic in a lay-by on the A64 before driving back to Drax for supper. Musically, although the punk movement was still pretty powerful, we were moving away from it to what was known as the New Romantic phase, epitomised by bands like Spandau Ballet and Duran Duran. Instead of the anarchic clothing held together with safety pins worn by the punks, the New Romantics wore heavy makeup, especially round the eyes, and dressed in an elegant, flamboyant manner. This was the music which Peter Powell and his producer Dave Atkey championed in their daily tea time show. One person who didn't feature in the 1981 Radio 1 calendar was Kid Jensen. I was less than happy when he told me he had been approached by Ted Turner's operation in Atlanta, Georgia, to co-host a daily news program. It was a very good deal financially, so I couldn't blame him for wanting to take up the challenge. Ironically, he was now managed by John Miles, who found himself in the odd situation of negotiating for his artist against the best interests of Radio 1. I liked Kid very much and had been a keen supporter of him on the network, so I was very sorry to see him go. It wasn't going to be a long absence, but we didn't know it at the time. In keeping with our broader range of programmes, we started our own weekly art show, this presented by one of our more innovative and inventive producers, John Walters. Tubbs, as John Peel affectionately called Walters, had been a schoolteacher and then a trumpet player with the Alan Price Set before he came to us as a Radio 1 producer. An educated man with a broad interest in the arts, he threw himself into his new Saturday show with producer Chris Lysett. Between them, they covered a range of music, art, entertainment, theatre, in a way that was unique. But John so loved the sound of his own voice that his long, convoluted questions would frequently last longer than the artist's response. On one occasion, he had in the studio Glenn Baxter, the cartoonist, and John Walters' opening question, with all its clauses, sub-clauses and qualifications, went on for 2.5 minutes. Producer Lysett confirms this as he kept the tape. Eventually, Walters concluded this rambling question. So, Glenn, what do you think? There was a 10-second pause before Glenn said, I'm sorry, John, you lost me. What was the question? Still, Walters Weekly was original and another demonstration that Radio 1 did more than pop and prattle. Unfortunately, it was very hard work and time-consuming for John, so we made the decision to rest it. We told Walters of this a week before he went up to collect a major award for the programme. His speech on the day reflected the nature of the man. I am very grateful to everyone who voted for the programme and delighted to receive it. But there's an irony about it, as I've just heard the programme is being axed. Actually, that's not quite true, as the expression used by the controller was that it is being rested. That, in my experience, is about the same as a mother walking down the street with her little child, and they see a dead cat in the road. Don't touch it, darling, says the mother. It's just resting. Walters Weekly was followed by another art-type programme with a slightly different slant, presented by John Peel, Peel's Pleasures. This was the first time John had started to branch out from being just a music man, to try his hand at a broader type of show, and I think it laid the foundations for him to emerge as the Radio 4 star of Home Truths, which he was until just before Christmas 2004. I had an odd relationship with these two, Peel and Walters, as they never entirely trusted me not to sell them out on the altar of commercialism. The truth was this, while I was not a huge fan of much of their music, I respected their integrity, and I knew they were as essential for Radio 1's success as the Top 40 output. They invented a jokey religion with a god called Snibbery, whom they professed to worship, Snibbery being responsible for the distribution of free promotional gifts and records. One day, when something I had done had annoyed them, one of them was heard to pray to Snibbery, put a curse on the body of Beerling the controller. By a strange coincidence, that was the very night I fell getting off the train and broke my arm, so perhaps Snibbery answered their prayers. I didn't give them any problems after that. The big event that summer, 1981, on July the 29th, was the wedding of Prince Charles to Lady Diana. We couldn't ignore the wedding of the year, so we took the roadshow into Trafalgar Square, where Andy Peebles had fun describing the procession and chatting to all the people who'd flocked to London for the day. Unless we thought to be too reverent, we also put on a Not the Nuptials show with Mel Smith and Griff Rhys-Jones. They were briefed to play many of their favourite records. But between the discs, in the words of Griff, we'll be taking a look at some of the matrimonial problems that can occur even in royal circles. As you might expect, it was very funny and quite inventive, but again it showed what a broad range of programmes our audience were coming to accept. I was still pretty busy as Doreen Davis was away for the whole of June and July, so I had to take on some of her executive responsibilities as well as organise another 2 weeks out. We did one in Scotland in March, basing ourselves in Edinburgh, and another in October when we had a very riotous time in Bristol. On the team were Mike Reed and Noel Edmonds, as well as the other great joker, John Knoll, who was there to help out with the disco shows. With these three, you have an explosive situation when it comes to game playing, and these boys went at it with a will. I remember John Knoll having a plan to take off the door to Mike's hotel room, as he intended to book a bricklayer to brick up the door with Mike inside. Luckily, that one proved impractical. However, Noel and John fixed Mike's room in a big way. There were kippers secreted behind the radiator. The bed legs had been removed and replaced with cardboard boxes, and the bathroom door was gently removed of its hinges and replaced. When Mike walked in, the door collapsed. In the bath, John Knoll had secreted a few live chickens, who of course went berserk at the commotion and started to fly all over the place. Mike ran out of the bathroom to sit on the bed, which then collapsed. Talk about pandemonium. Mike couldn't even call reception for help because the phone had also been disconnected. Controller Derek was less than pleased with the week out in Bristol. The thing that particularly got up his nose was an incident involving Simon Bates and his producer Malcolm Brown. They were doing a very good walkabout broadcast in Bath, which involved Simon in costume being carried round the city in a sedan chair, from which he described the sights and talked to various interesting people as he progressed the route. All went well until they got to the cathedral, where for some reason they were forbidden by the church authorities to go inside. These good people probably thought Simon wouldn't accord it due dignity. Malcolm was an organist and choir master himself in his spare time, so he was a bit put out at losing his potentially interesting insert. Between them, he and Bates arranged with the standby DJ in the hotel studio to put on an LP of organ music, which was playing under the report. In hushed tones, Simon chanted on. Here we are in the great nave, light streaming through the most wonderful stained-glass windows, casting a display across the flagstone flooring, and you can hear the organist practicing in the background. And he went on and on to describe the scene in the church, all of which he was making up by looking through the door. It sounded wonderful, but Derek happened to walk in the studio and found out what was going on. It was, of course, very wrong to mix fact and fiction, and absolutely forbidden by BBC rules, and Derek was furious with both of them. It soured his view of the whole week, and he told me so in no uncertain terms, which led to a bit of a standoff between us. Of course, in the light of subsequent BBC problems over deceiving the listeners and viewers, Derek was quite right. I was hurt, though, because all the work Dorian and I had put in had not been recognised by him, and we exchanged a few angry memos until we both felt vindicated. Back to Kid Jensen. Remember last year he had gone off to Atlanta to be a television newscaster? After 1 week, he and his wife Gudrun had had enough. As foreigners, they found it hard to be accepted there. It was very hot and humid. They missed the little things like fish and chips and pubs, and Kid had not enjoyed the work. So his manager, John Miles, sounded me out about whether he would be welcome to come back. I discussed it with Derek and the others, and we all agreed it would be very useful to have him back. When he did return, it was with a shorter haircut and without the name Kid. The experience had been good for him, and he had grown up during the time in America, so he thought it would be advantageous to become David Jensen. Peter Powell, meanwhile, was very involved with Radio Lollipop, hospital radio for children, and he raised money to equip a studio for them. We were also tied in with the National Motorcycle Training Scheme with champion rider Barry Sheen to try to ensure that the boys who had brought powerful motorcycles were taught how to drive them properly. Mike Reed was once again a source of management aggravation. He was good at presenting the breakfast show and had brought a fresh approach to it, but the problem was he wasn't reliable when it came to getting up early or turning up in time to open the show at 7 a.m. He lived in Weybridge, Surrey, so usually drove himself to work. His contract required that he should be in his studio at 6 a.m. to get everything together and prepare himself, but this seemed beyond him. Tommy Vance, who happened to be in a nearby studio, stood in for him on one occasion. On another, Andrew Turner, who was one of the Newsbeat readers, opened the network. Later in the year, we had an early show presented by Mike Smith, which preceded Mike Reed, so it was less critical as Smithy could always carry on until Mike Reed arrived. Mike always had a bunch of excuses, with a missed alarm call, a broken down card, or a lost swipe card which gave him access to the secure continuity area. I lost my patience with him, arguing that if he couldn't get there in time to present the biggest breakfast show in the country, he should be taken off it. Doreen, who was his executive producer, was more tolerant, and so was Derek Chinnery. So he wasn't taken off, but given a couple of written warnings. Steve Wright, another ex-Thames Valley chum of Mike Reed, blossomed at that time, with Steve Wright in the afternoon. Steve had listened to star DJ Rick Dees in America with his cast of idiots, and drew on this experience in creating his own afternoon posse of sycophants, the Afternoon Boys, who would join in on cue and make little contributions of their own. Steve, who professed to be not a well man and in need of therapy, was actually something of a hypochondriac. He used to hire the services of an osteopath, Martin Peters, and it was Martin's job to straighten Steve out and try to cure his aches and pains. Steve paid Martin to come in to service him, and Martin would come into Egton House with his portable treatment bench, but there was nowhere private where he could do this, so I used to move out of my office for half an hour or so that Steve could strip off and be done. What I had to do for my acts. Steve developed a number of regular characters on his show. They chipped in observation and sketches from time to time. Over the years we heard Sid the manager, Gervais the camp hairdresser, Mr. Angry the thug, Ruth and Damien the social workers. He even featured his brother Lawrence on the show as a character determined to stamp out clichés. This he did by making up some of his own. Touch the radio and feel the warmth of my sincerity. It was all very new to our audience at the time, and they fell in love with it. Soon the catchphrases from the character, I'm all right, you all right, and hello boy, were on everyone's lips. He even made records, I'm all right, you all right, and get some therapy, backed by the Sisters of Soul, who were the Afternoon Boys in drag, all profits to music therapy. Malcolm Brown was the original producer of Steve Wright, but in 1987, Jonathan Ruffle took over, and the show blossomed even more. Under John's influence, a regular team was built up using Richard Easter, Phil Cornwall and Mickey Wallmans. Mickey was actually the technical operator from the wireless workshop. Deborah Kinch and Claire Sturgis, both staff secretaries in Radio 1. This entire group became better known as the Afternoon Boys and Girls. They would give up their lunchtimes to experiment, write and record little sketches for the programme, and all because Steve and Jonathan gave them enough space to develop. The programme started to include serious interviews with top comedians. Harry Enfield, Ben Elton and Julian Clary all came in and recorded as live conversations with Steve, which were dropped into the afternoon programme. There were bollockings too from me when they went too far. There was a spate of complaints from the Rotarians over a series of spoof adverts made by Steve's team. The theme was a Mickey take on adverts for 0898 sex chat lines, but these spoof ones featured the very sexy voice of Claire Sturgis, who would suggest in breathy tones, Rotarians have spatula fun, wet style on naughty nights, phone 0898, etc. All very much in the style of innuendo borrowed from Round the Horn. When I hauled in Jonathan to complain, he always came up with the excuse, Honestly, Johnny, my uncle's a Rotarian, and he thinks they're very funny. He tried this on once too often, though, when I had complaints from the mental health charity, Mind, about the character Mr. Mad. My uncle's mad, he said, and he's got no complaint. Jonathan Ruffle was a very good producer. Steve said, Playing music is all very well, but there are many people at work who need to be entertained, and my show tries to be topical, fun and friendly. As a formula, it worked well. Well, it must be all right, because all these years later, he's still doing more or less the same thing in his afternoon show, now on Radio 2. I had some comedy fun too. I like to produce the occasional series, and after meeting with Robert Luff, his manager, it was agreed that Lenny Henry would make a short series for Radio 1. Robert was a tall, very upright, imposing man. His old-school tie, framed by lapels of a tweedy jacket and wearing cavalry twill trousers. He was a member of Lloyd's, an owner of a large hotel in Scarborough. He looked every bit like a retired army colonel rather than the manager of a major show business entertainer.
Lenworth, he said, I have discussed the ideas Johnny has for a series on the Radio 1 wireless network,
and providing I can reach a satisfactory agreement over the fees, I think you should do it. Lenny clearly loved Robert and valued his advice, so it came about that we produced our first series, 13 weeks of Lenny's Sunday Hoot. Like Noel Edmonds, Lenny was bursting with ideas for different characters and sketches to be included in his show, and these were coupled with a great knowledge of and enthusiasm for soul and pop music, so putting the show together was a real labour of love for me. Here we gave birth to Delbert Wilkins, pirate radio DJ on WBRIX from Brixton, Gronk Zillman, private eye of the 21st century, Trevor McDonut, who has to read the news, and Alfreda, the West Indian canteen lady, keeping us in refreshments. Radio 1 scored a wonderful publicity coup in a series of broadcasts by restaging Jerome K. Jerome's book Three Men in a Boat, which earned us a Radio Times colour cover with the crew in striped blazers and straw boaters. Our three men were Mike Reed, Paul Gambaccini and Noel Edmonds, who intended to take Hovis, Noel's great dame, with them, but the sensible mutt took sick before the off and missed the trip. They didn't use a rowing boat, but a 42-foot cabin cruiser, appropriately called the River Jester, in which they travelled from Hampton Court to Oxford. Mike couldn't swim, though Paul said he could manage 10 yards on his back. "Well, that's all very well," said Noel, "but can you swim through wreckage? We might go over a weir." Mike said he expected the other two to dress for dinner, as he was supplying a case of champagne and a Fortnum's hamper to keep them well fed. He fully expected that they would sup vintage port as they watched the sunset over the water. In practice, they were always dodging showers, tripping over ropes, falling in, and squabbling about who was to do the washing up. Mike took along his guitar just in case anyone asked him to play, and Paul his backgammon to pass the time. Derek secured a promise from them not to indulge in any practical jokes. Well, Mike had no fear of water. He had an Achilles heel regarding heights. We were all unaware of this until we put on one of our Radio 1 weeks out in Merseyside. The Lord Mayor of Liverpool laid on a civic reception to thank the whole team for the good publicity we had given the city. Mike, as the breakfast DJ, was one of the star guests. As we arrived at the civic building, Mike turned pale and refused to come in. "What's the problem, Mike?" "I've just realised the mayor's parlour is up on the top floor of that multi-storey civic building, and I can't go above four floors. I get sick with vertigo." "But you're one of our stars. Just go up there and don't look out of the window." "No, I'm sorry. You'll just have to make an excuse. I can't do it. I'm not coming in." And that was that. No amount of urging from Doreen Davis could persuade him to come in, and the reception went ahead without him. Even more energetic than the men in a boat was Simon Bates. Remember, he'd done a bed push a couple of years earlier. This year, he and his producer, Dave Price, undertook a cycle ride from Manchester to Cardiff. Bates on a Bike was staged to raise money for King's College Hospital, with a live broadcast every morning en route. Bates had done his best to get fit by doing some early morning jogging near his stables in Surrey. The sight of Simon, not a pretty picture in his shorts, and jogging had caused much hilarity among the local farmers. Just to make sure there were no steep hills on the route, he asked producer Dave Price to drive it before they started. On the first day, as they struggled up Congleton Hill, which was about 4 miles long, Simon said to Dave Price, "I thought you'd done a recce on this." "Well," said Dave, "it didn't seem like much of a hill in my Ford Cortina." There was a huge response to their efforts, and many professional and amateur cyclists joined them on the ride. Madness did a stint. Chaz and Dave turned up in suits, having worked late the night before in Watford, and then got soaked for their pains as it rained all through their stretch. Kim Wilde was the most popular cyclist by virtue of her good looks, and the public turned out in a big way to see her in shorts. Andrew Turner, the regular newsreader on Simon's show too, had come up and been conned into doing it because he had laughed at the whole idea of Simon doing such a trip. Through their efforts, they raised the money needed to support the ward at King's Hospital, and later we were to raise the funds for a Radio Lollipop studio there. While we were having fun, it was a different story on the other side of the world, in the Falklands, where British troops were involved in a war with Argentina, which started on April the 1st. The country was somewhat split between a jingoistic mood of defiance whipped up by Margaret Thatcher and those who thought it smacked of an old colonial approach.
As the war went on, the BBC took a fair amount of stick from Mrs. T for adopting an even-handed approach. But even on Radio 1, we lengthened our newsbeat summaries, believing it was right to keep our listeners, many of whom had relatives involved, fully in the picture. Thoughts of war were put aside for a few days as I became involved in yet another mad scheme at Easter. For a while we had been running music quizzes in the form of Musicology, Pop Quiz and Quiz Kid. Dafydd Rees, one of the music researchers on these shows, came up with the idea of a marathon music quiz. Mike Reed and Paul Gambaccini with Tim Rice were joint authors of the Guinness Book of Hit Singles, and as they had a formidable knowledge of pop, it was natural to get the three of them involved. We would do the radio marathon for not 26 miles, 386 yards, but 26 hours and 386 minutes. If you do the sums, you'll see this comes in total to 32 hours and 25 minutes all on air. What an undertaking. We decided to do it as a sponsored event in aid of the Nordoff Robbins Music Therapy Charity, so we could call on their fundraising committee, of which I was a member, to help with the staging. Through their and our contacts, we managed to get over 150 artists, personalities and background boys to participate. HMV Shops came on board as a sponsor, and we found a venue, the Bloomsbury Theatre in London. For the duration of the show, Radio 1 phone lines were open so that listeners could participate and pay to set questions of the two teams of contestants. We kicked off at 9:50 on Good Friday morning, when David Jensen set up the scene for the radio audience. The resident doctor from one of our talk shows, Alan Marion Davis, checked over the contestants for fitness to participate, and the question master, Mike Reed, was ready to start at 10 a.m. The Radio 1 team was led by Paul Gambaccini, while Martin Rushent, famous record producer, was captain of the show business team. The intention was that these three key players would be there for the duration, and the teams would come and go during the 32 hours and 25 minutes. In other words, till 6:20 p.m. on Saturday evening. It was very hard work. Phil Swern happened to set up literally thousands of questions, which involved dubbing little pieces of music onto tape, and Dafydd Rees wrote thousands more. The listeners too joined in with a will, excited by having Radio 1 stay on the air all night. They phoned in many more questions and were able to collect money via their pledges and donations. HMV Shops had pledged an additional £1,200 for a special feature within the show where Mike Reed was expected to answer a special series of questions from the members of both teams. To his credit, he got enough right to earn that extra £1,200. To this day, I'm not sure how Mike and Paul got to the end, but they did. It was a wonderful Herculean effort, and Radio 1 finally won with 1,506 points to the music industry's 1,274. I was really busy as we approached our 15th birthday. I'd been to Dallas for another week in August to produce the latest Jam jingle package. I went with Derek Mills, Radio 2's executive producer, and we arrived back a week before the actual anniversary. No time to recover from jet lag. In that week, I had to oversee the mail-out of happy birthday greetings cards to all our listeners who were born on September the 30th, 1967, approve picture selection for next year's Radio 1 calendar, check out the design and construction and progress of the new Radio 1 roadshow vehicle, organise a charity cinema screening of the film E.T., and edit our own Radio 1 15th birthday magazine. A week after I got back, Radio 1 celebrated its 15th birthday. Music and Video Week published a special supplement about both our station and Radio 2, which of course had come into being on the same date. After 15 years on the air, many of our younger listeners had not known a time when there wasn't a Radio 1. This was the cause of a dilemma which was to haunt us for the next 10 years, until I left, to be replaced by Matthew Bannister. How could we continue to appeal to the young audience with all the excitement there had been in the early days, while at the same time hold on to those older listeners who had grown up with us and who were not ready for the ageing delights of Radio 2? It was to take another 10 years for the BBC to get to grips with the problem. When it did so, it was in a brutal way that took no cognizance of what was being broadcast on Radio 2. the disastrous consequence in audience terms is now history. For our broadcasting celebration, we decided our main broadcast event would be a fundraising concert for Nordoff Robbins Music Therapy. Richard Skinner came up with the idea of reflecting the music we had helped popularise over the last 15 years. We called it the Heroes and Villains Concert. It was produced by Dave D and myself and promoted by Andrew Miller, who staged it at the Odeon Hammersmith on Tuesday the 21st of September. The Heroes were a number of the 60s beat groups, and the bands, all of whom gave their services free for charity. They were Chris Andrews, Cliff Bennett, Sandy Shaw, the Merseybeats, the Swinging Blue Jeans, Pan's People, Malcolm Roberts, the Troggs, Dave Berry, Junior Campbell, Dave D. Dozy Beaky Mick and Titch, Wayne Fontana, Chris Farlow, Carl Wayne, Billy Fury, Herman's Hermits, and the Nashville Teens. What a lineup! And the villains were the two Radio 1 DJs from the past, John Peel and Tony Blackburn. In the printed programme, Derek noted that Radio 1's 15th birthday coincided with the BBC's 60th birthday, so the network has now been in existence for a quarter of the corporation's life. So much for it going away. It was a great night. The bands excelled themselves and the audience loved it. And we broadcast a recording of the show a week later in Stereo FM between 10 and midnight on September the 30th, our actual birthday. As the summer drew to an end, Teddy Warwick, who had been Derek's chief assistant for so long, announced his intention to retire. I was sorry to see Teddy go, as he had been a good friend, and it was through his support that I obtained my first production job. Derek took the opportunity to reorganise the way we ran Radio 1. He brought in Stuart Grundy, an ex-Radio Luxembourg DJ and more recently a good documentary producer, to be executive producer responsible for the rock output. He decided it would be advantageous to have a head of Radio 1 to run the programme-making side and to deputise for him in his absence, as well as take over many of Teddy's responsibilities, and I was delighted when he offered the job to me. I had just completed 25 years in the BBC, and the extra responsibility was what I wanted. Now I was in a position to have more influence on the future of the network. From now on, we were on the air from 6 a.m. for an hour before the breakfast show. Mike Smith, who'd been away since 1978, gaining valuable experience at Capital, was welcome back to present the early show every weekday, and I was pleased when he came back. It wasn't too long before we gave him another break, when Mike Reed went off to do the road show, the year of the exploding guitar, remember. Mike Smith proved himself a very able deputy. In view of the way Smithy had shone in Mike Reed's absence, I would have thought Reed would have been even more circumspect about arriving in time. Yet we had another hiccup when his car ran out of petrol on the way from Weybridge. Bearing in mind Derek's earlier warning, he hitched a ride in a police van, so that on this occasion he didn't miss the start of the show. In the general election that year, the Tories won again, and Mrs. Thatcher was back as Prime Minister. It seems hard to believe now, but it was in 1983, too, that we played the first ever compact disc on Radio 1. Pete Ritzema was the producer, and Rock On was the show. The CD? That was Brothers in Arms by Dire Straits. Simon Bates and Steve Wright were becoming the best of chums and seemed to share the same madcap sense of humour, so we tried an experiment of sending the two of them out on a trip together. Not quite a full week out, but a week of Simon's shows in the morning and Steve's in the afternoon from the roadshow vehicle, and a range of locations all over the area. The first such trip was Simon and Steve in Scotland, where they operated out of a base in Inverness. Taking the traditional old song as a theme, it was decided that as they moved across Scotland each day, they would decide, by the toss of a coin, who should take the high road and who should take the low road. The reports on their travels were recorded to use in their programmes. Thus, one might get to travel by helicopter, while the other had to travel by public transport. On the trip from Glasgow to Stirling, Steve had lost the toss and was designated to travel by bicycle. That's quite a distance for a not-well disc jockey. So producer Chris Lysett suggested to Steve that they should start off on the bike. That's good for plenty of photo opportunities. Then, when they were outside the city limits, take the bike to a bus stop. It would make an entertaining little recording as Steve tried to persuade the conductor to let him on the bus with his bike. Lysette soon found a convenient bus stop with a lot of little old ladies queuing up with their shopping, and Steve joined them as the bus arrived. Plenty of atmosphere for their recording, as Steve stumbled amongst them and managed to get his bike wedged across the bus door. They were fully expecting a string of Scottish expletives and protests from the driver, which would have made an interesting recording. But to the contrary, he turned out to be a fan.
"Look, it's wee Steve Wright, isn't it? Make way, ladies, and you, Steve Larry, jump on. We'll have you in Stirling in no time."
I'd gone along to keep an eye on them, and so did producers Chris Lysett and Malcolm Brown, who, as it happened, were also good friends. The team was completed by two very competent production secretaries, Liz Redhead and Jeanette Cavell, as well as assorted outside broadcast engineers and Smiley with his sales staff. It had been a very convivial week, and we did eventually arrive in Aberdeen, where the japes continued. Nearing the end of the tour, we arrived at the very grand Culloden House Hotel. The owner was waiting by the front door to greet us in his full Highland dress. He was a sort of Basil Fawlty figure, and although he didn't have a piper to pipe us in, everything else was done in great style. This was not really the right place for us, and one could sense the disdain as our collection of vehicles and caravans rolled up his grand gravel drive and a load of scruffs in Radio 1 uniforms jumped out. I don't think it was quite what he'd been expecting when he'd taken a booking for a group from the BBC. Things started to get worse when the girls, who were on a fixed daily allowance, decided they didn't want to have the expensive à la carte dinner and asked if they could just have a main course at a pro rata rate.
"No, we're not that kind of establishment. We try to provide a full dining experience."
So there. After a few drinks, most of the crew went off to bed, except Chris and Malcolm Brown, as they had to edit some audio tapes they needed for the next day's broadcast. They turned Malcolm's room into a little production studio, and were working away till very late, scripting and editing. Around midnight, they were a little thirsty, and Chris suggested to Malcolm that he order some coffee from room service. Malcolm picked up the phone and waited a long time before managing to raise anyone.
Any chance of some coffee up here, please?"
A grumpy, sleepy voice answered.
"There's no room service at this time of night."
"Well, we're working. This is supposed to be a bloody good five-star hotel, and I'd like some coffee, please."
The phone was slammed down, and after 10 minutes there was a knock at the door. It was the same proud owner, now in his dressing gown and slippers, carrying a tray.
"Here's your kettle and a jar of Nescafe. If you want coffee, you can make it for yourselves."
By coming across like this, he was asking for trouble. During the trip, someone had presented Steve and Simon with a Scottish salmon, and this damn thing was carried around from location to location like some kind of damp pet. It got up to all sorts of tricks, and inevitably found its way into someone's bed one night. The poor owner must have got wind of what they'd been doing. Malcolm popped up to his room unexpectedly one day and went in, as you do, only to find the owner on his knees sniffing the sheets to see if he could trace the smell of fish. At least he said that's what he was doing.
"I know someone's been playing silly games, and I'll have no more of it in my hotel. If there's any damage to my bedding, you'll all pay for it."
I think Mr. McFaulty, for I'm sure he was related, was glad when we finally left. The almost schoolgirlish humour finally exploded during an evening recording at Boleskine House, the home of Aleister Crowley, which was now owned by Led Zeppelin man Jimmy Page. Chris Lysett had taken Simon and Steve there on the penultimate evening to record a piece about the Warlock. It was a drizzly evening. Malcolm went along for moral support. The DJs were tired, hungry and thirsty, and not in the mood for a complicated Lysett production. Chris did his best. "I want you to pretend you're walking up the gravel drive, and as you make the sound of your footsteps, Simon, you give a commentary about being on the shores of Loch Ness, about to visit the home of Aleister Crowley. Steve, you then ask, who was Aleister Crowley? And Simon, you will explain about him being a notorious warlock. Okay, got that?" Simon and Steve giggled a bit, learned their lines, and Lysett did a practice recording. He rather spoiled the effect by tripping over a bush as he walked backwards ahead of our speakers. Take two started. All seemed to be going well. The footsteps sounded realistic. An owl obligingly hooted, and the boys were sounding quite convincing. Steve.
Who is Alistair Crowley, Simon?
Simon. Alistair Crowley is the most notorious warlock Britain has ever known, Steve. Whereupon it all went pear-shaped. Steve, with a mischievous glint in his eye, departed from Lysett's script and said, "Isn't he the chap that used to go around fucking squirrels?" Gales of laughter and collapse of everyone, and to make matters worse, Jimmy Page wasn't at home when they did get to the great house. 1983 was the year when we finally had to let Edmonds go. He'd been with us for 14 years in all, and after completing one more Sunday morning series, he admitted his television commitments had now become so demanding that he could no longer give over time to do a regular Sunday show for us. I was really sorry to see him leave, and always hoped that one day I'd be able to tempt him back. It took a year. When I was controller, I managed to get him to sit in for a week on the breakfast show for Mike Reed. The other person who left our airways for good was Alexis Corner. That wonderful voice would be heard no more after he succumbed to cancer and died on January the 1st, 1984. He'd been a consistent supporter of Radio 1, an expert on blues, a fine guitarist who'd been very involved with the Rolling Stones in the early days of their career. He was someone who never sought fame or the limelight, yet he was a recording star, as his was the distinctive voice on John Cameron's CCS band's hit record, The Tap Turns on the Water. It was a pity about his addiction to those strong French cigarettes that probably cost him his life. What a loss to the broadcasting and advertising world, where he had been such a distinctive voice selling so many products. Later in the year, Alexis achieved some overdue recognition when he was given the Radio 1 DJ's Award for his outstanding contribution to music at the British Rock and Pop Awards. There to collect it on his behalf were his widow, Bobby Corner, Bill Wyman of the Stones, and his friend and producer, Jeff Griffin. I mentioned it earlier, and I'm not sure what was the reason for it, but there was always a deal of rivalry between Mike Reed, on at breakfast time, and Simon Bates, who followed him mid-mornings. There was yet another row between them in February. This time, though it centred around Mike Reed, several of the other jocks were pretty pissed off with Simon. He'd read a piece in The Sun about what went on behind the bike sheds, and without thinking of the possible consequences, he turned it into a feature for his own show by inviting listeners to write in if they knew any secrets about our current DJs and what they'd got up to behind the bike sheds when they were young. Simon said he was looking for a few funnies, not serious scandal. And as if that wasn't enough, he went on about it again the following day with an offer to reward any listeners who could give him good tittle-tattle about Mike Reed's youthful activities, adding, "I don't suppose he'll be speaking to me after this." With no love lost between them, there was a big row. Derek had to be involved, and Simon received an official reprimand. It didn't do a lot for station morale. I was less than happy with Mike Smith, too, as we moved into 1984. His radio career had been building nicely since he returned from Capital, and he was now doing very well in the daily lunchtime spot. In parallel with his radio work, Mike had also been making appearances on television, working with Noel on his Saturday evening show, and on BBC Television's new Breakfast Time. This was a little difficult for us, as it put him in direct opposition to Mike Reed on our own breakfast show. Mike felt that Breakfast TV was too good an opportunity to miss, and in March he told me he had decided his future was there. We had to let him go. It provided an opening for Gary Davis to be promoted for what was to become Gary's Bit in the Middle. As well as losing Smithy, one of my other favourites, David Jensen, did a runner, but not back to America. Unbeknown to us, he had been approached by Capital Radio, and without as much as a hint from anyone, we were very hurt when they held a press conference to say, "David Jensen has signed with us." I was particularly hacked off with him, particularly as we had gone out of our way to welcome him back after his year in America. As he was in breach of his contract, we terminated it immediately, so there was no chance to use our airwaves to say goodbye. Why should we keep him hot for local radio in London? I'm sure those listeners outside the capital area were somewhat mystified as to why he disappeared so suddenly, but that was the way it had to be. John Peel was very upset too, because he and David had been presenting adjacent Radio 1 evening shows and had cultivated a Rhythm Pals act. John said at the time,
I actually cried when he left. At Wembley that summer, we were involved with our biggest live concert to date, the summer of 84. John Reid, who was Elton's manager, told me he was working with another promoter, Mel Bush, to put on a huge concert. Although we didn't know it then, it would turn out in technical terms to be the dress rehearsal for 1985's Live Aid. The summer of 84 concert was to have Elton as top of the bill, with Paul Young, Nick Kershaw, Kool and the Gang, Wang Chung and Sector 27. The idea was that we would start early afternoon and go through to the evening. There was always a curfew at Wembley because of the noise problems with local residents, so we couldn't go on very late. The show would be broadcast live, with the Radio 1 mix of sound also being supplied to a television truck where John Reid was having the show recorded for subsequent TV release. We had the rights to the live performance, while John and Mel retained all the others. Our DJs presenting the various performers were Simon Bates, Gary Davis, Andy Peebles, Anne Nightingale and Steve Wright. It was a wonderful June Saturday. The weather was perfect as 72,000 people packed into the stadium and everyone was in a good mood. Sadly, Paul Young developed a throat infection on the day and was unable to sing, so he had to pull out and was replaced at the last moment by the lads from Scotland, Big Country. The crowds were so enthusiastic, it was terrific. I was standing backstage looking out at this mass of expectant and happy, eager faces as Steve Wright was about to go on stage to introduce Elton John. "Oh God, I'm scared, Johnny. I've never talked to an audience that size in my life." "Steve," I said, "just think about it. They only represent a fraction of the number of people listening to you every single afternoon." "Oh yeah, that's right. I never thought of it like that." And off he went, quite happy to play up to the audience who loved him as much as they loved Elton, who followed him. Having stood at the side of the stage and witnessed that mixture of response, warmth and emotion which came back to Elton as he performed, I can begin to understand what makes a performer want to go out and do it night after night. I'm sure that sensation is addictive and leaves the performer with a high from which it takes hours to come down. In July, we went across to Northern Ireland to start another roadshow tour. And as there was still a sense of nervousness about going, I went along to show solidarity with the team. Jimmy Hawthorne, controller of BBC Northern Ireland, was so pleased that we continued to come to help spread some good news about the province that he gave a party at his house. Present was Steve Wright, who was fronting our show, the rest of our team and some of Jimmy's senior people, including Robin Walsh, the head of news, and Dick Francis, who was by now the managing director of BBC Radio. Jimmy and his wife Patricia were very good hosts. The food was excellent, the drink was flowing freely, and in the words of Van Morrison, the crack was good. I was standing in the corner when Robin Walsh came over and a very significant conversation occurred. "My God, Johnny, I never knew you were going to be important." "What are you talking about, Robin? I'm not important. You've known me for years. I'm the man that runs the roadshow." "No, not now, my son. You're destined for better things." "What on earth are you on about?" "Dick Francis just told me, and he should know. You're the man who's going to be the next controller of Radio 1. As Derek still had nearly a year to go before he retired, I was staggered. As far as I knew, I might be in with a chance, but there were several other strong candidates. They would all be competing for the job, so how could Dick Francis have made up his mind? How would he persuade the Board of Governors to go along with his selection? How much could I believe what was being said after quite a few drinks at a very private party? I was thrilled at the notion, but I took it with a pinch of salt, and we would have to wait another 6 months to see if Robin's prediction came true. Back in England, following the success of Three Men in a Boat, we came up with a sequel, In Search of Wigan Pier. Janice Long was another good presenter, discovered by Derek Chinnery during our week out in Merseyside. She had been developing nicely in her evening show, but for this project, we decided to team her up with Simon Bates for a week of broadcasting during daytimes. It was to be a sort of Radio 1 boat show. The boats were a canal barge, the Tom of Silsden, a longboat equipped with a DJ desk and some PA speakers so the people on the bank could hear us, and another cabin cruiser, the Craven Queen, as an accommodation vehicle for Janice, Simon, producer Chris Lysett and me. In Search of Wigan Pier progressed from Skipton to Wigan in the course of a week. The first night
we moored up near the bridge by Busy Liz's, the famous fish and chip shop in Skipton, and as the weather was good, Lysett and I decided to sleep on deck, only to be very rudely awakened by some local yobs who decided it would be fun to relieve themselves of the local ale off the bridge and all over the sleeping chaps. We weren't very amused, and little did I know then that years later I would find myself living in Skipton. As we progressed along the Leeds to Liverpool Canal, the crowds turned out to watch us as if it were a roadshow, which it never set out to be. Because the boat travelled so slowly, the crowd stayed with us in a sort of Pied Piper fashion, and it grew as the week went on. As a thank you for all the good publicity British Waterways had enjoyed, as a result of the broadcast, Derek Chinnery, Janice Long, Chris Lysett and I were invited by the British Waterways Board to a dinner at Houghton Towers near Blackburn. Simon Bates didn't come because he had been roped in to compare one of the BBC's public meetings, It's Your BBC. He'd obviously enjoyed a fair bit of BBC hospitality after the meeting, and eventually he staggered back to find us all asleep in our bunks. Because he was so happy, Simon thought it would be very funny to let off a dry powder fire extinguisher in the cabin where we were sleeping. If you've ever inhaled the contents of one of those in confined quarters, you can understand the terrible effects on the lungs. I was closer to the door and managed to stagger out, but I really thought Lysett was going to die. He coughed and coughed and was sick for about an hour before anything like normality returned to his features, and we still had to cope with a layer of white powder over every single item in the cabin. It certainly sobered Bates up. At the end of that September, the original launch DJ, Tony Blackburn, was finally out of a job on Radio 1. "Tony Blackburn leaving after 17 stormy years," was the headline in The Sun. He didn't go gracefully, feeling that he was undervalued by Derek and generally unwelcome. Tony held the opinion that the BBC owed him a job for life and he never wanted to go. In recent years, he'd been doing regular shows every morning on BBC Radio London, where he could indulge his passion for Tamla and disco music and talk about his big 12-incher. This type of presentation was, he felt, more in keeping with his personality than the one he had to adopt at Radio 1, where he was still doing Saturday and Sunday children's request programmes. Through an enforced smile and perfectly gritted teeth, he said, "The time has come to make a change." He went as he began, closing his request show with Flowers in the Rain by The Move, the same record we'd opened Radio 1 with 17 years earlier. Radio 1's long-term relationship with the Variety Club had continued to flourish, and by now we had raised over £500,000 for Sunshine Coaches. Another celebratory fundraising lunch was held at the London Hilton, and to give it an even higher profile, we broadcast Gary Davis's Bit in the Middle live from the ballroom. On January the 15th, 1985, I went for my interview for the job of Radio 1 controller. I suppose I must have given the right answers because towards the end of January it was announced that I was to be the new boss of Radio 1. Derek Chinnery was due to retire at the end of March and that was to be the date for the handover. In practice, he more or less allowed me to take all the decisions once my appointment had been announced. It was time to do things my way and I couldn't wait to start.